Thank you. publishing was a very important part of Beethoven's livelihood, so it was good that he knew him. And so Diabelli commissioned a group of variations. He actually asked 50 composers in 1819 to write a variation based on the waltz that you heard at the very beginning, the thing that's called a tema in your program. And this was going to be good advertising for his publishing company, which was known as Coffee and Diabelli. And it is of interest, have you heard of Franz Liszt? It's of interest that the very young Franz Liszt, who was 7 at the time he was asked, actually contributed a variation to this collection. And so his teacher, Carl Jarrett, who had been a pupil of Beethoven, so there's a connection between Liszt and Beethoven. But anyway, what was Beethoven going to do with that waltz? Beethoven thought that it was a cobbler's patch, so he didn't really think a whole lot about the waltz. And yet, he didn't just write one variation, he wrote 33. And one of these is a very grand double fugue, and never mind what that means, just know that they're hard to write. Beethoven, in his later years, wrote as many fugues as he could, and he was a way of maintaining sanity. So anyway, 33 variations on a waltz that he didn't particularly find impressive. So what are some ways of listening that might help us to put the variations into groups or categories? Well, Beethoven tries to exaggerate certain features of the waltz in some of the variations. So let me point some of those things out.
We have this grace note idea. And then we have these repeated notes, just chords. Then we have this smoother, more legato articulation. It's like a tag in the left hand. So that's a little thing that he's going to capitalize on. And then we have this really banal back and forth seesawing between tonic and dominant. You're going to hear echoes of all of those things in the variations that follow that waltz.
You'll wind up putting variations in different categories according to how you listen. So if you're going to listen for changes in tempo or speed, then you're going to group all the fast ones together and all the moderate tempo ones together and so forth. If you're listening for dynamics, loudness, and softness, then you'll put loud ones in a category, soft ones in a category. Articulation, that staccato short articulation, there's a lot of variations that exploit that. Register, you know, are they high, or are they low, or are they mid-register in the piano? That's another way of grouping things. And then, of course, a waltz is in three-quarter time, isn't it? And so the waltz at the beginning is clearly in three-quarter time. But there are a lot of variations that aren't. And so you might group them according to the meter that they're in, or the time signature. And then there's texture. A lot of homophonic textures, which that's a fancy word for melody, and then accompaniment. So you'll hear the right hand playing a melody, and then the left hand doing some kind of chords to accompany. But then there's other times when we have polyphonic textures. And so I mentioned that fugue earlier. There's also an almost fugue called a fugetta. And those are polyphonic sections where you have multiple melodies going at the same time. So your attention's kind of split between activity up here, activity here in the middle, activity in the bottom, so forth. But then there's the emotional affect that a variation has on you. And I made copies of a little sheet called the Hebner Circle of Adjuvants. And this is actually still used, even though it's from 1936, it's still used in the field of information, music information retrieval, which is very hot. It's a hot field right now because it has a lot to do with how music is marketed and how people choose the music that they listen to on iTunes or other places. So this is the Hebner Circle of Adjectives, and so maybe as you're listening to the variations that follow, you can assign a number from that circle of adjectives that you think is important. appropriate. And it may be that more than one number seems to apply to a particular variation. So just try your hand out.
Thank you.
like what you would be. Which one?
Humerus or vigorous? 5 or 8?
Well, of the second group that I play, which one?
16.
Well, we can talk about it later.
16.
We can talk about it later. Who did Beethoven dedicate this work to? That's the question. Well, he dedicated it to Antonia Brentano, the wife of Franz Brentano, who was a merchant of Frankfurt. And he was 15 years older than her. And she didn't like having to move from Vienna to Frankfurt. And then when her father was about to die, she and her family moved back to Vienna to be with him. And that was in 1810. And it was at that time that a friendship with Beethoven began. And Beethoven was actually a friend both to Antonia and her husband, as well as the children. Now, some of you may have heard of the immortal beloved. After Beethoven's death, there was a letter to someone that he did not name. He just referred to her as the immortal beloved. It was found among his things. And it's in three parts, dated July 6th morning, Monday, July 6th evening, and July 7th morning. And it took a while, but most Beethoven scholars came around to deciding that it was written in 1812. 10 years after, 2 years after Beethoven had become friends with that family. And it was written in Teplitz, which is a spa town in Bohemia. And Beethoven liked to go there in the summertime. Maynard Solomon, a modern-day Beethoven biographer, points out that from the letter, it is learned the immortal beloved had been in Prague and in Carlsbad around that exact time, and that Beethoven and she might meet again. And there's clear evidence from surviving guest registries that the Brentanos were in Prague and probably in Carlsbad too at exactly that same time. And that applies to no other woman that was in Beethoven's life. So for this and other reasons, then this particular scholar feels that Antonia Brentano, the one that he dedicated this said variations to, that she is the immortal beloved. That's his thought. But it's a controversy. It still has not been solved to the satisfaction of everybody here. There are other candidates. Now you notice in variation 22, it says, alla notte di giorno faticar di Mozart. What in the world does that mean? Well, it means like or in the style of aria from Mozart's famous opera, Don Juan. And Leporello, who is the servant of Don Giovanni, sings this aria, which basically is translated night and day, I slave away. And so if you know the aria, then you'll probably recognize how Beethoven is quoting basically the introduction and then developing it into something that resembles Diabelli's Waltz. So that's very, very clever for him to incorporate a quote within to morph it into the variation that still has something in common with the Diabelli Waltz. So then what are we to think of a last variation? That's the question. Does it come as a surprise? Does it feel right to you? Is it appropriate? The expression marking in both Italian and German may be a little revealing. It says, in the tempo of minuet, but then he says, nicht schleppen, which means do not drag. So it's one of these things that we see in a lot of Beethoven, especially in the later years. He's trying to get at a very, very specific mix of emotions. It's not a pure emotional state or an extreme emotional state, but it's an kind of some kind of in-between state. So that's why you would say something like that. Tempo of minuet, but don't drag. Anyway, when you hear the last variation, just think about it and see if you think that is an appropriate climax to this set of variations. In fact, maybe it's not a climax at all.
Thank you.